Hi, my name is Jesper Pedersen. I come from KDAB. If you just joined us, welcome. This video, which is a part of a larger group of video where we're looking at images and transformations and other stuff, we've reached the point where we'll see how can we do custom transformation. I'm sure that just above my head you see an analog clock, you know, those that we used to carry on our arms way back then, that actually is animating right now. The analog clock might not be as beautiful as what you would have developed for your custom projects at home, but at least you get the idea of it being an analog clock, and it's made out of three images, that's all. Those three images form the analog clock by being transformed. Well, one of them isn't transformed at all. The background image, that's basically looking like this, isn't transformed. Then we got two arms. We got one here, and you have to think of the other one too, that's here. Those two arms are transformed. They are transformed not around the topmost, middlemost, whatever you call that point. That's not how it works. Not transformed around this, not how it works. Not even transformed around the center of the image, not how your arm worked on a clock. No, no, it's transformed around this particular point here. That is where, had this been a real analog clock, that you would attach that arm with, however they do that, and then it rotates around that point. And that's the transformation that we are doing in this example here. So let's look at how that is done. The way that works is by simply setting a transformation ourselves on a property called transform. That property, if you look at the documentation, you'll see that transform takes a list of transform. So the transform element, a list of those, the way that we do that is by square bracket, then a transform, comma, another transform, comma, yet another transform, and then the close bracket, however many transforms that you want. If you only want one transform, then you don't even need the square brackets, as we'll see in the code. So one of the images that you see, one of the arms up here, is set up with code that looks pretty much like this. So transform, colon, and then rotation. And as you can see, we have rotation, scale, translate, and matrix 4x4. Matrix 4x4 gives you the full power of transformation. You can do whatever your math geek, your inner math geek, is able to do with this matrix 4x4. But if all you want to do is rotate, scale, or translate in a specific way, then you can just use one of these three prepared elements. So down here you can see there's no square bracket that would otherwise be sitting around here, and then square bracket there at the end, but that's optional if we only have one element. So I got my transform. That is a transformation of the image. It's the rotation element has two properties, origin X and origin Y, that tells us exactly what is the point in my image that I'm rotating around. And then an angle, and just on the slide here it says 90, but in the real code it's an animation that we will see. So let's go and look at the real code. It's a rectangle that's light gray. So I just run my clock here side by side. You can see there's a big gray rectangle here at the root of it all. It is 500 by 500 in size. The item is, that rectangle has an item inside it where I do some scaling on it. And the reason why I scale is that, do I still have it running? No, I don't. Let me run it again then. The reason why I do this is that my clock actually is able to work in different sizes. So you see, if I make it very tall or very wide, then the clock is still a round clock. It would look pretty weird if the arms or the tick marks were sitting all the way out there, all the way out there, and then the clock would be going really slow and then really fast around those few degrees out there, and then really slow again. So for that purpose, it continues being round. So that's what we do here. We figure out what is the real width and then do the math of what is the minimum. Is it smaller in width or is it smaller in height? That was this mean scale up here. And then the scaling that I do down here, sorry for the confusion before, the scaling I do down here is to get my background scaled so that it fits exactly the min width. And if we just open up, you can see the actual background image here. It is enormously big. My designer who created this for me decided to create a really big image there so that when I scale it around that it would look good still. Had he done 100 times 100 and I scaled it up to 500 by 500, then I would already start seeing effects. But scaling down makes it look better. You can see here 3480 times 3480 in size. That's the size of this image here. And we are back at the code here. So I have this item here. I do the scaling here and I set this transform origin. Remember from the previous video that I usually scale around around the center of the image, but this time I actually wanted to scale around the topmost leftmost corner so that my image there is scaled down up to the visual area. Otherwise, I would scale it down, it would sit down here and my visual area would be this part up at the top. So that's what I do there on that transform origin. And now we set the image to the background, and here is the key thing. That is the slide here, or the arm here that I set up with an image. The source is small arm. So let's go and see what small arm look like. We got that one here. It's not really small, is it? But it's the small arm that we have here. And actually, the designer gave me a dot in the image. Of course, that was his decision that it would look good with a dot right where it's attached. So I could now bring up some image tool that could calculate how many pixel it is down to the center of this dot. I know that the center in the width is exactly halfway in, and that's not close to create this time. That is what you see here. So the small arm here, its X position is the background width divided by 2 minus the width divided by 2, and the Y is the same thing, minus 914. So that's how I position my arm so that it's standing exactly at the right point here. That's my center point of my clock here, my center point of my arm there. They're standing right there, and I'm positioning it as if it was pointing upwards. Now, that's the first part. The next part is that I need to apply my transformation. I do so by saying transform and then this rotation. And we have a bit in here that's looking forward in time. Well, in time of this recording, of course, we haven't seen animations yet, but hey, now you see it. So the animation says that the X point, that is the small arm dot width divided by 2. So that is, I know that this point down here is exactly the width of my arm. The width of my arm divided by 2, that's my X, and my Y is 940 pixels from the top down there. I measured that in an image tool where I could see that. And then the angle, I got this rotation animation on angle. It goes from 0 to 360 times 2, so goes around twice the small arm, so that's a 24-hour day. And it does that in 60,000 milliseconds, which means 60 seconds. So in 60 seconds, I will have a 24-hour day condensed down to running around there. And I got the animation that loops infinite, so that my clock continues and continues to run around. Same thing for the large arm. The only difference is that this time I measured it to be 1255 down, and you can see my X and Y for positioning my arm so that it's right at the center, pointing upwards. It's slightly different here, it's at 1255 there. And then the rotation down here is rotating again, 60 seconds, this time 24 times around, so that's 24 hours in a day, and an infinite one. And this angle, colon 90, This is really just to get that into the slide, so sorry for that. But what you'll also notice is that I start out with an angle, but my rotation animation is starting right away, and then it will be using that angle. That's it for this video. We saw in the previous video how we do transformation. In this, or just transformation, the general rotation and scaling, this video we saw how we could do very custom transformation. And of course, sometimes your user interface is not rotating around and it's not being transformed in one way or the other. Sometimes your user interfaces is really just laying out things next to each other, on top of each other. And that's exactly what we're going to see in the next video when we're going to talk about a layout manager, the first layout manager of a few different ones that we have in QML. We're going to talk about the anchor layout. Thank you very much for listening. If you haven't done so already, please do subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you'll be notified about new video releases from us.